So we're going to invite our panelists up, and I am so honored that I have my own staff member here, Sonia Marziano. The great Sonia Marziano is going to act as moderator. She's like, enough of that. Take it away, panel.
Thank you. All right, give us a second to get settled. All right. Thank you so much for coming out this evening and to the beautiful DuSable Museum. My name is Sonia Marziano. I don't know how great I am, like Kyla just said, but I do work with Kyla as a project coordinator at the Smart Chicago Collaborative. As she said, this has been a wonderful month of women's stories, women in technology, women in who either work in civic technology or with civic technologists. And what has been really unique about this series is these personal narratives, talking more about past the roles, past the products of what we build, and more about how we got there. And it's been a very exciting month. So tonight it's not going to be any different. We are going to go a little bit more into the personal narratives of the amazing women. Behind me you will see a photo series. So in lieu of slides or presentations, we decided to pull some really beautiful personal and professional photographs, and these are a way to see their communities, the people that they care about, their passions. And so this feels very special to me, and it was a great thing to be able to put together. So each panelist will have their own story to tell, and then we're going to have a short discussion, and then we'll have some questions from the audience as well. So let me introduce you to everyone. So to my left, we have Tiana Epps Johnson. Tiana is the founder and executive director of the Center for Technology and Civic Life. Prior to CTCL, she was the New Organizing Institute's Election Administration Director. She and her team provide resources and training to support local election administrators in modernizing the ways they communicate with voters. They also publish free open source civic data sets that have been accessed over 200 million times through some of the most powerful tools that drive civic participation. Tiana holds a master's in politics and communication from the London School of Economics and a BA in political science from Stanford University. Additionally, she was a technology and democracy fellow at the Ash Center for Democratic Governance and Innovation at the Harvard Kennedy School for the 2015-2016 academic year. Then to Tiana's left, we have Aviva Rossman. Aviva is the chief operating officer and co-founder of Ballot Ready. Ballot Ready is an award-winning nonpartisan online voter guide to every race and referendum on the ballot. Aviva grew up working on campaigns at all levels, including her own successful election to Chicago Local School Council. She began her career with Teach for America, teaching high school math, and leading the special education department in Chicago. Aviva has a bachelor's and master's from the University of Chicago, both in public policy. And then last but not least, we have Andrea Hart. Andrea Hart is a Chicago-based multimedia journalist and interdisciplinary educator. She is the co-founder and director of community engagement at City Bureau. She also currently serves as a local news consultant for the Democracy Fund. Since 2010, she has designed collaborative journalism programs for leading youth media organizations such as Young Chicago Authors and the Yolo Kali Arts Outreach. In 2016, she served on the Hive Chicago Learning Network Advisory Committee and continues to freelance teach as well as creatively consult for other organizations. She was a 2016 Vocal Foundation Social Entrepreneur Fellow and was a Fall 2000 recipient of a Shuttleworth Foundation Flash Grant. So I wanted to go through all of these introductions because they're, first off, amazing, and they have a lot of achievements, but it was also to get past these professional achievements and then now create space for these personal narratives. So I would like to turn it over and to Tiana and see if you would be willing to share some of your personal story.
How about now? There we go. So when I was growing up, I spent a lot of time after school hanging out with my grandma. My grandma is my favorite person on the planet, I think in part because she's my grandma, but also because objectively she is an extraordinary human being. So here's just a few examples. She's a strong Black woman who graduated from high school in Little Rock, Arkansas the year before schools were desegregated. She once scored nearly 60 points in a Navy basketball game. She managed to get an advanced degree in organic chemistry, all while raising 5 kids with a husband who was overseas in the military. And she'd probably kill me if she knew I was bragging about her to all of you right now. When I was about 10, my grandpa passed away, and my grandma decided that she would fill some of her time by going to law school. And when she was taking her classes, I really loved reading her law books while she was actually studying the things that she was getting the degree for. And I remember really vividly being excited when I was that age about being able to tell like the nuanced difference between what assault meant in the law and battery meant in the law. So I was just like a normal 10-year-old doing 10-year-old things. But it was during that time that I was convinced that when I grew up, I wanted to be a civil rights lawyer. So fast forward about a decade, I was a bright-eyed undergrad studying political science, and it was my junior year, and everyone on campus was taking different semesters off to go study abroad. So I had friends that were going to Madrid and Santiago and Paris, and I decided to study abroad in Washington, D.C. And I landed this internship at the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights under law in their voting rights section. And at that internship, I was helping support their voter hotline where people can call in if they have questions about basic things about how the voting process works, like how they might register or where they needed to go to vote, or if they needed to report things like intimidation or deceptive practices that were happening that were blocking or intimidating their ability to engage the process, or other problems like long lines at the polls. And I was really struck then about how challenging it was, not only for the general public to be able to navigate the voting process and some of the really fundamental questions that were hard for people to find answers to, but also how challenging it was for these lawyers who were trying to support people in navigating the voting process. Also, ironically, when I was working at the Lawyers Committee, surrounded by lawyers, I decided that maybe I didn't need to go to law school when I grew up. My direct supervisor was an organizer, not a lawyer, and it became really clear that there was different pathways to make a real difference in lots of people's lives that didn't require me to spend a lot of money on law school. So in 2010, I found my way back to Washington, D.C., and it was then that I was hired to help create the first free, open source data set of all of the polling places in the country. And this data set in 2010 was published through a Google search tool that anyone could go and put their address in and get back the answer to a really simple question, where do I go to vote? And that cycle, over 7 million people were able to use that tool to answer some of the questions that we were trying to support people in answering when I was at the Lawyers Committee. And it was through that work where, for the first time, I really got a taste of the role that technology could play in advancing civic engagement. When I took that job in 2010, I had never worked on a technology project before. I really didn't think that when I grew up at any point I was going to go into technology, but I pretty quickly found my bearings. So in 2015, I moved here to lovely Chicago and with co-founders launched the Center for Technology and Civic Life. And as was mentioned, our focus is modernizing how local government and communities interact with the focus on making voting easier. We're a civic tech organization, but the lion's share of our work is really focused on building relationships. And I'm super stoked to share that in 2016, we ran the largest nonprofit voting information program in the country. Through partnerships with companies like Facebook and Google, we helped tens of millions of people find answers to some of their really basic and fundamental questions about voting, like what's on my ballot. And we also were able to help hundreds of local election officials across the country build better data, design and digital skills to be more effective at engaging their communities. Maybe more importantly, last month my grandma celebrated her 80th birthday. And I got to be there for a big surprise party that we had for her in Georgia, where she lives now. And it was a blast, and she continues to be phenomenal.
Thank you, Tiana. What was your grandma's name?
Rose.
Rose. I think I would love to see Rose on this stage in the future. She sounds incredible.
She's in the middle of one of the family photos that's up there.
Okay. We'll keep our eye out. Thank you. Aviva, would you share a little bit about your story and working with Ballad Ready?
Yeah, sure. Is this working? Yeah. Okay, great. So I grew up in Boston, and one of the great things about living in Massachusetts is you're like literally 45 minutes away from like 10 other states around there. And for me, as a kid growing up obsessed with politics, this meant that my dad and I could drive up during the primaries to New Hampshire and really do a tour of everyone who was around there doing events. So I remember when I was in middle school, we did Bill Bradley, and then we did Al Gore, and then we tried to get into a George Bush event, but we had to stand outside on these boxes in the snow to try and like peer in and see George W. Bush. So I grew up and I loved politics and I loved campaigns. And actually that year in middle school, my dad and I we took the day off, we drove up to New Hampshire on election day and we knocked on doors for Al Gore. And if you remember the results of the 2000 election, Al Gore won the popular vote, he lost the Electoral College, but he lost literally by like 4 votes. If he had won New Hampshire, he would have been president. So I felt personally responsible. Like if I had just gotten into a couple more doors, you know, we would have had a different outcome. And this continued, so in high school, my dad and I did the same thing. This time we took it up another level. So he pulled me out of school and we cashed in our frequent flyer miles. We flew down to Florida and we spent 2 weeks knocking on doors there. Again, John Kerry lost. Again, if he had won Florida, he would have won. So I started to feel like this was a pattern. I was a little bit worried about my electoral participation. And as a side note, like a couple weeks later, my dean pulled me out of class and said, Aviva, you're failing 2 classes, what happened? And I said, well, there was an election, man, like I had to go to Florida. And luckily I ended up passing and getting into Chicago, so string of my teeth. So I came here though, and I loved Hyde Park. I really enjoyed being part of the city, but I always wanted to work on a campaign. That had been my dream growing up. So I took a quarter off of college in 2008, and I made the decision not to work on the Obama campaign, but to work on a congressional campaign going on in the northern suburbs. But basically, no one understood this. So I spent 2008, the night of Election Day, all my friends were in Grant Park, my family was in Grant Park, and everyone's calling me, congratulating me. And I was, of course, sobbing in a ballroom because my congressional candidate had lost to Mark Kirk, and I had continued my curse on campaigns. So after that, I said, all right, I'm done with this for now. This has been a lot of fun. I got to experience sort of my dream, but I was really interested in public policy and I really wanted to do something that allowed me to get a better sense of just what it's like to work in a community and to get to just know the people of Chicago better. So I ended up going into teaching and I taught here in Chicago for 4 years. I was lucky, I had the same homeroom all 4 years, 20 girls. And so at the end of the 4 years, they were going off to college and I decided I was gonna go back to school and go back to studying public policy here in Chicago because clearly I couldn't get enough. But as I was leaving, I really wanted to stay involved in education and I wanted to stay involved in my neighborhood. So I decided to run for local school council. Does everyone here know about local school councils? Okay, so for those of you who don't know, you should look them up because they're very interesting. They're so unique. They don't exist, I think, anywhere else in the country. But basically, each school in CPS is governed by an elected body. So these are parents, teachers, principal, and community members, which is what I was, who are actually elected. And they have the power to hire and fire the principal, to set the school budget, monitor the school improvement plan. So they actually have a lot of power. And actually, my local school council, right before I was elected, shut down a Trader Joe's from coming into Wicker Park because they didn't want all the traffic around their school. So it's fascinating how much power these elected bodies have, but really no one knows about them. So when I ran, I did what you do when you run for office, which is you make a list of every single person you know. You go through all your Facebook contacts, all your LinkedIn, all your Gmail, and you basically make a spreadsheet and bug everyone to make sure they come out and vote for you. And one of the people I ended up talking to was my friend from way back in college named Alex, and I said, you know, well, you can vote for me. And she said, well, I didn't even know there was an election, but sure. And she ended up not actually showing up to vote for me, but luckily I still won with 96 votes. But I didn't hold it against her. We kept talking about this problem, and we both realized that we'd had this experience of walking into a voting booth prepared to vote for president and unprepared for a lot of these lower level officials. And this is coming from me, as you can tell, a real political science junkie. I was ashamed to admit it when I got to Illinois. I had no idea we elected judges. We don't do that in Massachusetts. And I was like, I don't know what to do here. I'm just going to guess and go for all the women. And what I discovered as we started talking to more people is that literally so many people do this. We talked to political science professors who do this and political journalists. And so Alex and I had this idea, and we decided we were going to start Ballot Ready. And the idea was to make it really easy for people to have information in one place about their entire ballot so they wouldn't have to guess and they can make informed decisions. So I went back to policy school. I went to some classes, but really I got really excited about working on Ballot Ready. And we started off really small with paper voter guides, just trying to figure out how do people decide what to vote for. And from there we bought our friends pizza, and we did a hackathon, and we built our first version for the Chicago mayoral runoff. But since then we've been really lucky. We keep getting support, we keep finding people who believe in solving this problem. We've been able to keep building voter guides so that this past election we were live in 12 states, which was 15,000 candidates, 300 ballot measures. We had over 1 million visits to our site. So I sort of ended up back on a campaign. My husband kind of told me he never wanted me to be on a campaign again because I was pretty crazy when I was on one. But working for Ballot Ready has really allowed me to have this opportunity to get to the heart of democracy, which is making sure we elect the best people and making sure, you know, we hold people accountable for their records.
Thank you so much. Andrea? Is that good?
Yeah,
cool.
Hello. Yeah, so I'll take this back a little bit. So a lot of my work, I think, centers around things that I've learned and I'm unlearning, having grown up in a largely like single mother, very low income, low tech household. And I think there, one of the pictures is of me and my mom after I ran the marathon. But yeah, so I think a lot of the things that I've done in my life are sort of undoing the, like, seemingly shame, like things that she's been ashamed of because she grew up poor. You know, she dropped out of high school to support her family. She, when she got married and started having children, she quit her job at Mary Kay to stay with the family, and like that had a lot of financial consequences when my parents got divorced. And so I think a lot of my life has been, you know, I grew up around her and like that, the shame that she carries, and then so everything I think I've done, it has been a way to kind of show her like, hey, I'm gonna swear, fuck those stereotypes about like single mothers and like poor mothers and like, let's do this. So that's sort of like the primer to me. But yeah, and like, and I wrote this essay when I was like 8 about, or I think I was like 10, about how my mom is the greatest in the world. And I ended up winning this essay competition. And so I decided, I was like, I'm gonna be a writer, but I wanna make money, so I'm gonna be a journalist. Yeah, that's funny. I ended up getting, because I was poor and smart, a full ride to Northwestern, which was awesome, but I think being there, I was still constantly unlearning that sense of shame, like feeling like I didn't quite belong, like because I didn't have a lot of the trappings that the fellow students did, and I was like holding down 3 jobs and all of that. And so it was actually, I ended up doing, so Northwestern makes their journalism students think they're doctors and they give them like a journalism residency. It's just an internship. And so I ended up doing, I had never been abroad. I didn't have a passport. So I applied and got into the South Africa residency. And it super changed my life. There's so many, like, studying abroad changes your life. But it really did. I was covering immigration issues. I was doing investigations into undocumented Zimbabwean youth or minors coming into South Africa, and had followed this trail of some unconstitutional, illegal things that were happening at the border. And it was telling those stories, and particularly the narrative of a 17-year-old undocumented Zimbabwean immigrant, telling her story and thinking about, man, she could tell her own story. She's quite articulate. There's really no need for me to be here. Well, yes and no. And so I think that experience, since that experience, I've sort of been sitting on it, looking and involved myself in different media projects, always thinking about how do you center it. You know, there's that terrible narrative of giving voice to the voiceless, and that she had a voice. It was the institutions I felt like were deaf. And so I think I'd been sitting on that since I was 21, and after graduating, ended up working at Patch, which was an AOL Huffington Post experiment in hyperlocal news. So trying to figure out how do you do community news better. And I jumped from that back into teaching. So I basically worked for every youth media nonprofit in the city of Chicago. And again, thinking about how do you empower people to tell and share stories, and what does that look like? And feeling like there was a ceiling always of, you know, there was always a dog and pony show, especially working at Young Chicago Authors, where I was the only journalism teacher and I wasn't teaching poetry, and always questioning, you know, the poetry festival. Okay, it's great to have young people on a stage performing, but who is it for and what is that next step? You know, they're sharing these really amazing stories about injustice in the city, but who's buying tickets to the shows, and like, who are the patrons for this, and like, what is that next level? And so a few years ago, I met Daryl Holliday, who was an editor at DNA Info, and he came and talked to my students. I was then at Free Spirit Media. So we were talking about our frustrations on both sides of the coin of journalism, whether it was editorial or education, and just started talking about what if we did our own thing. And it just, I mean, we just have been lucky that the industry's been collapsing in such a way that we've become this shining light, sort of, in the city of Chicago. Silver linings abound. But so he and I were talking about what if we could put community at center, what would that look like? What if we had this journalism lab? And we roped in two other people, Harry Backlund, who was the publisher at Southside Weekly, because he's a business guy and he's good with money and he knows how to sustain a weekly newspaper. And then Bettina Chang, who's the web editor at Chicago Magazine. And so the four of us got together and started riffing on what we could do. And this was a year and a half, 2 years ago. And so we came up with City Bureau, and we are now only a year and a half in of actually doing programming, and have successfully raised over $300,000 in that first year. Because I think folks are super excited about how we do media production. We have a fellowship. We have a freelance network of documenters, which we came out of a partnership with Smart Chicago Collaborative, where now anybody can train and become a journalist. And we also host a public newsroom workshop series, which is happening tonight, not far from here at the Experimental Station. We do that with Southside Weekly on a weekly basis. All of this sort of centering around, if journalism is a public good, what does that mean and what does that look like, both in the process, not just in the product? So yeah, and it's been a really exciting ride.
Awesome. Let's give these ladies a round of applause. Thank you so much for sharing your stories. I've learned a lot about each of you that I didn't know before, and I love how all of your stories have touched upon empowering and informing these residents or communities. So thank you for what you do, and thank you for sharing. I wanted to ask if you felt like you were a technologist, and what does it mean to be a technologist if you do feel that way? And I'll open it to anyone who wants to respond.
I'm not a technologist. I consider myself an organizer, or a media-based organizer. What does that mean? It means how is the storytelling process? How can you get folks organized around it, especially thinking about information sharing when it comes to journalism, and how do folks want information delivered to them? So yeah, and technology does play a role in that, in terms of how you connect with folks, but my primary focus is thinking about organizing and information sharing, and then the technology is sort of an afterthought.
I mean, I feel quite similarly. Technologist is one of the hats that I would say that I wear. As I mentioned before, so much of our work is really focused on relationship building and listening and understanding people's challenges, and how or if technology is something that might help to solve those or help to make progress on those challenges. And so, yes, I think about the way that data might power different platforms and think about products, but that's a small part of a lot of the work that we do at CTCL.
You know, I haven't used that word before, but I feel like as I want to reclaim it as a woman. When I was a kid, I used to love math and I used to love technology, and I don't know if I've ever told anyone this who knows me, but in fifth grade I had my own Harry Potter website that I developed called Harry Potter Mania. It was like super cool. It had my own Harry Potter Monopoly board on there and Harry Potter games. But I think after that, you know, I started to feel like technology wasn't for me. It was too complicated. It was something I was never going to learn. And one of the cool things about starting ValidReady is the opportunity to really delve into APIs and shapefiles and really understand more the technology that undergirds things and just the potential that it has, which makes me regret that I didn't, you know, learn coding earlier and delve into computer science because it's something I really enjoy. So maybe I'll go with budding technologist, but I definitely agree with these folks. There's a lot more that goes into it than simply, you know, making a software or hardware product.
Awesome. I love the idea of reclaiming the word technologist and becoming that. So, Tiana, you mentioned that this idea of if technology works, like you wonder if that it's not always a technology solution. So I wonder, how does technology fit into the communities you work with? And I guess, what are some of the challenges that you might see with technology solutions?
Yeah, so one of the primary communities that we work with, or in some ways organize, are election officials who serve the public at the county level or at the city level, depending on where we are. And one of the things that we've noticed, which is just a global trend, is that more and more people are consuming information through technology, whether it is on their mobile devices or through social media. And oftentimes the election officials that we're working with are people who have been government officials for decades, but have been slow to have the resources or the training to be able to understand how tech might inform them, better understanding the audiences that they're serving, and connect people and engage people in the voting process. And so, for us, we often find by listening to these election officials that there are tools that can help them better engage and inform their communities. But there are also times when we find that a good old-fashioned open house is the best way to bring people into a space and help them better understand the voting equipment that might be there. We find that sometimes technology is a perfect fit for helping with a pain point in a government office, and sometimes some of the more traditional methods are really what a community needs.
Awesome. Andrea or Aviva, do you have any similar experiences where you see maybe technology or pieces of technology being a barrier to your goals?
I mean, I think there's lots of promises of the web, right, in terms of openness. But I think from a media perspective, you have to address issues of distrust that are sort of have been there regardless of the web, and also realizing that given that, and then also given just limited access, what are the physical low barrier of entry spaces where you can engage folks? So then maybe the technology starts becoming a little more accessible. So I think for us, we're always thinking about how do we meet folks where they're at, and a lot of that involves engagement in libraries. So I've been spending a significant amount of time the last few months in libraries, and it's been great, both for the research that Sheila and I have been doing for Democracy Fund with Sonia and Denise, and also, you know, I did a training in the Auburn Gresham Library, and I was getting, you know, the 7-year-old woman to tweet. It was really fun, but it was meeting her where she was at. She could walk to that library, and I could come there easily and train her how to do that. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think for us, you know, we are a tech solution. We're online, but you know, the key to helping people make an informed vote is really less about the platform as it is right now, and more about the design and helping people find that one piece of information that's most important to them. And that's actually what we found just with paper voter guides. You know, we asked people to highlight what's important to you, and we discovered there's some people who really care about experience and have you held political office before, and there's some people who really just care about the endorsement of the Sierra Club or Planned Parenthood, and then there's some people who just really care about education, and that's the one issue that they're going to vote on. And so what technology enables us to do is to create a design that's responsive and helps that one voter find the thing that she cares about the most. But I would say it's much more than just a computer or a mobile smartphone. It's really about the thinking and understanding voters' minds. And then just like you, training people, helping people to access it. We've had people in nursing homes do trainings for all their other nursing home residents about how to use ballot writing. So that's gone into the design too. How do we make it so simple that anyone of any age can use it to cast an informed vote?
And I think what you're getting at, especially that peer-to-peer learning, is what gets pushed away when you use a term like technologist, right? That there's this sense, there's a different power dynamic versus, you know, things like civics and media. Again, those should be publicly, you know, public spaces. And so therefore it should be allowed that there's peer-to-peer learning that can happen. But when you throw terms or jargon in it like technologist, it's like kind of seemingly tilts the power dynamic a little bit.
No, awesome. So since we have a group of community members and technologists, and I think self-proclaimed technologists in this room, what would you say, what advice would you give, especially to the technology sector, to do better at either amplifying community voice or engaging with communities? Like, what is your key to success in engaging with residents?
Well, I think one thing I saw, so we came out of UChicago, and one of the first things we did was we won this competition at University of Chicago's Booth School of Business. And it was so funny because so many of the businesses that come out of Booth are like solving a problem that's only applies to Booth students. And I think the best example of this is there literally was something that won in New Venture Challenge that was a car sharing service to get from the Loop to Hyde Park and back again for classes. And I think it's just a missed opportunity because, you know, obviously Booth students have some money to spend, but they're a very small percentage of, you know, the people on this earth. And there are so many people who have problems that I think could be solved by startups and by technology. And so I think it's on communities and for people in tech in general to start talking to people who are beyond their maybe immediate circle. We might think of a venture capitalist or who a person who starts a startup is, and say, what problems do you have and what solutions do you have? Because there's a huge opportunity there to solve a solution for so many people.
Yeah, I think like at City Bureau, when Daryl and I go to meetings to try to identify community partners, we always start the meeting with, what do you need? Do you even need to work with us? And also I think really checking yourself, do you have a deficit-based approach to this community, or are you recognizing the assets in this community? And I think those things are really helpful.
I would say that you don't always have to start a new thing or create a startup or launch an app yourself. One of the trends that I've really seen, in particular following this election, are people who are really fired up and want to get engaged for the first time. And I've seen, you know, a ton of folks, especially in the civics sector, launching tools that, you know, if for those of us who have been working in this space for 5 or 10 years, could help to advise on sort of the pitfalls of those things. I would recommend instead to find people who already have relationships or are already working in community and plug into those existing efforts rather than just trying to solve for your own problem that you feel.
So we've been talking a little while. I want to ask one more question before we open it up to audience questions. I'm really curious what you think are good ways to encourage women to participate in technology, and maybe not fully, but like maybe it's technology and community organizing, or maybe it's politics and technology. But how would you encourage women to approach the technology sector?
As someone who has, you know, been building and growing an organization where I hope to continue to attract women who are technologists. I would say that a big thing that we focus on is what is not just what it looks like to have a pipeline of talent or get someone in the door, but what does it look like to actually have a work environment that is inclusive and that has a culture that keeps people there and keeps people happy. And so when I think about culture and startups, it's not like whether or not we have a ping pong table in our office. They're the things like the policies and the values and the norms that take a lot of work to establish, but are really fundamental to making sure that you're creating workplaces where everyone can thrive.
Yeah, I think for me, just seeing more diversity everywhere is so helpful, and not just women, but everyone. You know, being in the startup world, we just go to a lot of meetings with white men, basically, and we meet a lot of founders who are, you know, young white men in hoodies. And I think partly it's when you're a woman or you're any sort of minority, if you don't see yourself, it's hard to imagine yourself in that position. But I think also on the other side of the table, you just approach things differently. So like, one example we ran into is when you're starting a startup, you have to, you know, show projections for 5 years to your funders and they sort of evaluate them. And what we learned later is that a lot of guy founders go in and they're like, man, we're gonna crush it the next 5 years, we're gonna be at $1 billion before you know it. And so the VCs who fund them have just learned to cut those projections in half because they're like, oh, these guys are just, you know, making it up. And then when a lot of women approach this problem, they're like, okay, let me sit down and think. Like, I think I could conservatively make, you know, a couple million dollars. And so they don't do that, and then VCs still cut it in half, but they're, you know, completely overlooking that there's a different outlook. And I think that sort of problem can be addressed when you have more diversity at the table, when you can recognize where someone is coming from. That just opens up a completely different pipeline because it's not only that you see more people like you, but you have people that understand you, both sides of the table.
I kind of want to flip the question because I don't think the fault is in women. Like, I think we should be thinking about how do we get men to, and like cis men, to stop being like, stop perpetuating patriarchy. I think we have these conversations. I have these conversations with my friends about race. It's like white folks are the ones that have to do the work because they're the ones perpetuating the racism. And so I think it's like, how do we get men to do that work? Or just, you know, stop funding them. I mean, that's where my mind is at, because I think until you start getting them to have some culture shifts, it's not, I mean, women are awesome. They do this work, you know, without very limited access. And so I think it's teaching that larger, like, male culture, okay, well, what the hell, let's get this together.
Do you have any ideas for that?
I think stop funding them.
Sorry, guys.
I think that's part of it. Or really being thoughtful around, and this is me coming from like a media perspective and thinking about community engagement in media. I think for foundations being more thoughtful around inclusivity and actually asking and thinking about who's in these spaces and what am I funding? What am I saying that I'm perpetuating? Especially knowing now, doing this research with Democracy Fund, how foundations feel foundations funding media feel responsible for what has happened in the presidential election. Like, oh, we were funding the wrong things. And so I do think there's this opportunity to have this real conversation around, well, who are you funding? What did they look like? Why are you not looking in these spaces that are maybe smaller and don't look like you, you know?
One follow-up question, I promise to give it to the audience. Since you're all founders of your respective organizations, what is one way that you have ensured inclusivity in your organizations?
For us, we have prioritized among very limited time actually establishing, we have a staff handbook that has clear policies. In our first year, we, at our staff retreat, prioritized defining what our values were, and one of them is inclusion, and we have very clear things about what that means in practice, both internally as an organization and also about what the partners that we choose to engage with, and then recognizing that there was additional cultural work that still needed to happen beyond like these policies and values. We prioritized at the beginning of this year at our staff retreat to dig into culture and norm setting. And so we have right now working groups that are people on our staff that are all bringing to the table different ideas about how we might establish better norms as an organization that will help to ensure the culture that we want to create. And some of that will get translated into policies, and some of it will translate into just expectations about how we operate as a staff.
That's awesome. I wanna like learn from you guys. I think the biggest thing that we've done is just thinking about our hiring. Like, a lot of times when you hire, you just hire from your network. And we recognized that when we did our first round of hiring. That was where we got our referrals to. So now, as we're preparing to scale up for 2018, we're being much more conscious now about building that network, building connections so we can reach out to more diverse people and just try and get more people who share our values and meet these goals of inclusion.
So CityBeer is a nonprofit news organization, and there's four co-founders, and that's very intentional, and all of us are very different from one another, both like physically and in our backgrounds, because we are very much aware of the nonprofit industrial complex and the single white founder who like never leaves the organization because mommy and daddy's money are tied to that funding. Not speaking from experience and working at a nonprofit like that. But anyway, no, but so we're very conscious of that. So there's four of us for that reason. And then also in terms of our hiring, you know, when it's our fellows, we ask them, you know, who are you and how does your identity matter in this journalism that you want to see in this world? So I think it really does start with hiring practices. And then from there, it just becomes easy, you know, and we are always looking at the stark, terrible, you know, percentages of how many white men are in newsrooms, and even still, even as they're dwindling. So I think those are always like, we always remind ourselves of what the larger landscape looks like, and then we just try to really provide and be an inclusive space, and that includes all walks of age, gender, race, whatever, ability.
All right, I'm going to see if there's any audience questions. Okay, I think people are being shy. There definitely has to be a question or two. Yes.
Yeah, and I was being a little extreme, but I mean, I think, you know, there's women's studies, there's gender studies, but there's no real space for men to talk about, like, toxic masculinity unless they're getting called out on it. And so I think, you know, within City Bureau, two of the co-founders identify as cis men, and so we have those conversations all the time, and I think because we're friends, we can talk through that stuff together. But we do also think about, you know, with our fellows, the kinds of intentional training we have and who do we bring in the newsroom. But it's a small group, so it's nine fellows typically. So we try to weave it in our weekly training sessions. But I do think, I think lots more spaces should be having men-only spaces where they can talk through these things in companies, because I don't know many that exist.
Yes, I think there's mics right up here if you don't mind coming down. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Hey, thank you so much. I hope you don't mind. I've been live tweeting a lot of what you're saying, because it's really good. One thing I'm curious about, as founders, if you can think back to right before you embarked on your venture and now comparing it to now, what are the things that were maybe like easier than you thought? What was way harder? Like, what would you tell yourself if you could go back to when you were just about to start these new ventures?
I think one of the things I would tell myself would be to develop more relationships with people who are founders, as well as people who have had experience starting organizations. Some of the most valuable advice that I have gotten are from other folks who are experiencing similar challenges around fundraising for an organization, measuring our impact, telling our story, and so that has been really key, both for like the practical things that I've learned from them, but also for having that space to be able to just ask questions like, will I always stay up at night worrying about cash flow? The answer is yes. but it's nice to have someone to ask that question over a glass of wine with.
Yeah, I'll echo that. Finding a community of founders has been really cool. And I think the flip side, too, is just finding mentors. And I think at the beginning, maybe it's hard to be more vulnerable about where your startup is, and you just want to like make it seem like you're crushing it all the time. And what I've learned is the more honest you can be, especially with mentors, you know, you want them to think well of you, but if you can tell them, this is what we're really struggling with, like, we are struggling with cash flow, we're struggling figuring out how to collect content, it just makes those relationships much more valuable and ultimately deepens them, I think, and makes them respect you more.
Yeah, I think the thing I'm still telling myself is, you know, you're okay. Like, you don't have to keep trying to apply for other jobs and, like, hiding to your co-founders about that. Like, you could just, you're good. So that's the thing I'm still telling myself. But then also, I think, make the big asks, like, constantly. Don't undersell yourself, because City Bureau is really lucky that because of, there's four of us, we have a really nice network of folks who've been on our advisory board and are now on our board, and we have access to things that I think we forget about sometimes because we're just too busy doing the work. So I think, I mean, again, that's still probably a reminder, but like make the big ask and don't be humble because you're doing the work.
As a follow-up to that, one of the really amazing pieces of advice that I got from a woman who was a mentor for me was that when fundraising, it is just as challenging. You have to jump through like all of the hoops to get a grant that is $75,000 as it is to get one that's $500,000. So ask for $500,000 and work your way back down, like rather than the other way around. And that was also really helpful advice.
Yeah, and I had one of our female mentors said, when people say no, just ask them again. And then she said that happened to her. She's an investor, and she said no on a deal, and they came back and said, we really think that you will like this. And she said, you're right, okay, I'm gonna give you money. So that's something I have to remind myself a lot, too.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
So I don't know if you all talked about this before, and I apologize for coming late, but I wanted to know how much has the organization that you have now changed from the vision or idea that you had at the beginning?
Yeah, that's why we call City Bureau a lab. Because we fell back on that real quick. Also because, you know, there's no mistakes then, everything's an experiment. And so, yeah, I don't think we would have envisioned getting as much money as we've gotten in the first year, and also honing in on these three very specific programmatic areas, and then also see, oh wow, they all work together, and you're creating this pipeline, and this is what, when we said a public newsroom, this is what we meant, you know. So yeah, I mean, a lot of words that we threw around now have meaning and like now have a physical thing attached to them, and that's crazy.
Yeah, I think one quote I like is, fall in love with your problem, don't fall in love with your solution. And so I think we've stuck on the same problem, and then figuring out how to solve it has evolved over time. So we used to have college students do all our research, and basically we found out that they were wholly unreliable. Like, we had this hackathon, they were supposed to collect information, and there was a puppy parade outside, and they all left, and they didn't do any of the research. So we found a different way to collect the information, but we're still like trying to solve the same problem, and just figuring out the best way to do it.
I think for us, we had a sort of a unique founding because our founding team actually did the work that we're doing now as an independent organization for about 4 years before founding CTCL at a different nonprofit. And so we got to work out a lot of those like initial growing pains under the umbrella of a different nonprofit. But one of the things that has really changed is just how our organization has grown and become more professionalized. When we first founded CTCL in 2015, myself and my other two co-founders moved from DC, like drove here in a minivan. We all lived in the same apartment and worked from that apartment. It was a big deal when we finally got office space. and it's nice to not all live together anymore. And those are some of the major changes that also have like pretty positive impacts on our work.
Any final questions? Okay, go ahead.
So in my everyday work, I work with a lot of future women. And, I try my very best to, empower them to be able to think, and understand how strong they are and how capable they are. But I can always use more advice or things to say to them to sort of counteract all of the things that they hear outside of the safe space that I try and create.
I want to just say something. So I know you were at our Home and Square event yesterday, and I think it's awesome that you're tackling that issue of empowering young girls and that you're trying to make them feel better. I think it's awesome to see men in the position of empowering young women. So I just wanted to add that.
I think you should read a lot of bell hooks. I think there's lots of things within her writing that can help inform the kind of space you want to make where they just feel empowered, not for being a woman, just being a human,
Well, thank you so much. I think you're all staying for the rest of the evening. So if you do have questions and we're shy to come up in this space, please reach out to Tiana, Aviva, and Andrea. And I just want to thank you for closing out the Women's Speaker Series this month and for the wonderful conversation. So thank you.